Hey, Livingstone. Thanks for tuning in to worship with us today. Our church council met this week, and we've set June 7th as the first Sunday we'll resume in-person worship gatherings at the church building. Now, obviously, we'll be doing some things a bit differently than before the pandemic, and one of those things is that for now, we will only be gathering for worship at the church building. Other gatherings like Sunday breakfast, nursery, kids and youth meetings will continue online for now. We'll be sharing some updates before June 7th on some precautions we'll be taking, but I'm just excited that we'll be able to meet together again soon. Now, I know some of you may not feel comfortable attending worship in person just yet, and we totally understand that. We'll continue to make our worship meetings available online for the foreseeable future so that you don't feel pressured to return before you're ready. Our adults will continue to meet for Bible study on Zoom this Tuesday at 10 a.m. and 7 p.m. And I want to encourage you to choose the time that works best for you and join us. If you haven't joined us because you're unsure about how to use the Zoom platform, please contact me and I'll be happy to walk you through it. Our K through 5th grade teen kids will continue to meet this Wednesday at 6:30 on Facebook Live. And our 6th through 12th graders, our youth will meet at 7:30 on Zoom. Finally, it truly amazes me how you all have continued to give faithfully toward the ministry of our church during this time. We've set up online giving at livingstonebaptist.org/give. And you can also mail your gift to our church at P.O. Box 378, Portageville, Missouri. Or you can contact our church treasurer, Julie Boyd, and drop off your offering to her. Let's pray as we begin our worship time. Father, we thank you for the privilege that it is to be able to worship you, even through an online platform like this today. And Lord, we pray that as we hear your word preached today, as we hear testimonies given, as we sing songs of praise, that you would just be honored and glorified, that you would stir up in our soul feelings of worship and gratitude and thankfulness for your grace and mercy in our lives, and that you would speak to our hearts in a fresh way even today. Father, we thank you that we are able now to look forward to a date that we'll be able to begin meeting again. And Father, I pray that you would just help all things to come together as June 7th approaches so that we can provide an environment that is safe for all, but also that you would just be honored and glorified as we begin meeting in person again too. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. I hope you'll join in singing this first worship song together.
All the way my Savior leads me, what have I to ask beside? Who can doubt his tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divinest comfort, here by faith in him to dwell. For I know what am before me, Jesus, who with all things well. For I know what am before me, Jesus, who with all things well. May falter in my soul, a thirst may be gushing from the rock before me. Oh, a spring of joy I see gushing from the rock before me. Oh, a spring of joy I see. Thank you. cross above. When my spirit cold and mortal wings its flight to realms of day, this my song through endless ages. Jesus led me all the way. This my song through endless ages. Jesus led me all the way.
What an awesome reminder that our Savior leads us every step of the way through every trial we face, and that whatever happens, we know that He doeth all things well, and He promises to work all things together for the good of His people. For our missions moment today, we're praying for Deanna Deere. Deanna was raised in Portageville and now serves as a full-time missionary with Campus Outreach. And our church has had the opportunity to partner with her for the past few years. I had the privilege to record a ministry update with Deanna this week on Zoom. Let's take a look at what the Lord has been up to in her life during this season. All right, Deanna, thanks for joining us today and sharing an update with us. Why don't you just start kind of briefly? I know that the pandemic sort of changed the whole end of the school year for college students, and I'm sure it affected ministry for you. Can you just give us a little bit of an update on kind of what campus ministry has been like these past couple months and how you've seen the Lord at work?
Yes, for sure. Hello, everyone. Glad to connect with y'all, and I hope everyone is staying safe. Like Todd mentioned, I guess in the middle of March or beginning of March, most of the universities went on spring break, and that's right around the time that the pandemic began to peak. And so most of the students on our campuses didn't return back in a normal way from spring break. And so our face-to-face connection with the students kind of ended the 1st of March. And so since then, it's been a lot of adapting for us as college ministers to continue relationships that we've been building, to continue investing evangelistically, helping them continue to be established in their faith, and moving forward spiritually even while at home. And so as many of you can probably relate, it's been a lot of hours in front of the computer screen, whether it's staff meetings or one-on-one evangelistic meetings or discipleship groups or just calls for encouragement to make sure the students are doing okay at home. We have really relied on technology to connect, and it's been really encouraging because we have seen God continue to save students, even in the midst of being separated from each other face to face. We've seen students go home and be an encouragement to their families. I've seen multiple students kind of just reporting back and sharing encouragements of how God has used their faith and them even just reading the word while they're at home to stir up spiritual conversation with unbelieving family members. And so we have seen God continue to save and continue to grow people in their faith. And it really has been encouraging to see like the process of spiritual multiplication. What we're hoping to see is investing in one person that they'll go and invest in others. And we wouldn't have picked this pandemic or the situation, but God is using it and for His glory. And He's continuing to work on the college campus, even while people are not physically on the college campus.
Awesome. That's great. Deanna, since we've been partnering with you the past few years, normally around this time, you've been asking us to pray for like summer ministry. I know you guys have done like the Tampa Project, Orlando Project, and those kind of things. What's that going to look like for you guys this summer, and how can we be praying?
Yeah, this will be my first summer since I think becoming a Christian that I haven't spent growing in my faith alongside of other people in Florida. And so it's a very different opportunity. But this summer we have created what we are calling the Summer Leadership Project. And it's a virtual discipleship opportunity. And right now over 350 students have committed to be a part of this discipleship project. And that's really encouraging in a lot of fronts, because a lot of people who weren't ready to make the step to spend 10 weeks in Florida have, you know, made the decision, I'm going to invest here virtually and locally within my community, and I'm committing to grow in my faith. And so it seems like, even though it's not our ideal or our preference, we're able to reach a broader scope of people with our virtual leadership project this summer. And so we'll continue to invest in young believers and help them be established in their faith through teaching and modeling and doing it with them in the areas of reading the word, prayer, evangelism, and fellowship. And so we are looking forward to it. It's been a lot of change and adaptation, but we're expecting that God will use it to not be the exact same as what we're used to, because a lot of the life on life piece that we get by going to Florida will be missing. But we're really trusting Him to use this broader scope of reaching more people and being able to establish more people in their faith this summer to keep building laborers on the campus. And so we're very excited for it. And it's kind of been fun as staff to be creative and have to make the best of the situation at hand.
Awesome. We'll be praying for that. And it sounds like, I know the interpersonal part of ministry is disappointing that won't happen down there, but you know, the fact that you've got a lot of students signed up is cool. Hey, Deanna, the last update that we shared with the church was probably back late February, early March, about the opportunity that the Lord has given you in Zambia this fall to help lead a campus outreach team over there. Give us just a quick update on that. And I'm sure that the last couple months has thrown maybe a little bit of a wrench in that. I don't know, but just share with us how that process is going and how can we be praying for you?
Yes, for sure. The past few months in terms of moving towards solidified plans to move to Zambia has been a bit challenging for me personally. It feels like a lot of my life is kind of up in the air in terms of what I would have hoped for at this point. But the encouraging part is the plans are still moving forward. It just is a different timeline. And I think that was something I had to really personally grasp, was I thought the hard part was going to be committing and surrendering to God to move 8,000 miles away. But actually what's been harder is to just wait on His timing. And I feel really convinced He's still moving me there. But it just is in a different time frame than I had planned. And so originally I had hoped to go in August and begin language school and be prepared for the team to join me in January. Now it looks like my departure date will be somewhere between October and January. It still kind of depends on what happens with the coronavirus, but that is the plan moving forward. And I think something that's been really encouraging for me during this time of waiting has been that three people have committed to be a part of the lead team with me. And so recent college grads who are figuring out what to do with their life in the middle of a pandemic have said, I want to commit to go across the world and live out the Great Commission and share my faith on the college campus and trust God to raise up disciples. And so that definitely feels like affirmation from the Lord of we're still moving forward. Things just look way different. And so in the meantime, we are just working towards our team goals of connecting and building relationships, and then also raising our funds that we'll need to be able to launch as soon as the borders open.
Okay. Some of our folks that aren't aware, I know that, you've got to raise some monthly support, but I understand there's sort of like a one-time cost of just sort of getting over there and getting established and all that kind of stuff. Is that right?
Yes, there is. And so I need to raise around $1,500 of monthly support to be fully funded and prepared to go. And that will be like my ministry costs and salary and the means that I'll live on over there. And then there's a one-time amount of $30,000 that I'm trusting the Lord to raise, and that airplane and housing setup and all the things that you need when, you know, fees and visas and all those things when you move to another country. And so that is a big part of preparing to go. And also a huge trust God that you guys could be praying alongside of me. It's like, if fundraising wasn't already hard in the middle of a pandemic and just uncertainty, it's a lot to trust the Lord for. And so I would appreciate prayers for that.
Sure. Well, we're going to put the link kind of just in the YouTube description for this video that we're sharing with the church for where they can go. And, you know, if folks want to donate, you can just click the link here in the description of the video, and it'll take you to Deanna's campus outreach fundraising link. So, Deanna, we want you to know that our church is praying for you, and we're just so thankful for the way the Lord is using you on the college campus, and look forward to how he's going to be using you overseas in Zambia, hopefully soon.
Thank you so much. Thanks for y'all's partnership. I really am just beyond grateful for y'all's continued prayers and giving. I really feel sent out, and just that we're in this together, and so I'm really grateful.
Let me pray for you, okay? Father, I just thank you for Deanna. I know that the coronavirus pandemic has made ministry just different for everybody, local churches, as well as campuses. And Father, we pray that you would, as she continues to connect with students over the summer that have committed to the summer leadership project, Lord, that this would just be a fruitful time of discipleship, even though it looks different than planned. We pray you just use it for your glory. Father, I do pray that as Deanna and the team that she'll be working with is making plans for getting just established in Zambia, getting moved over there and started hopefully in the fall or late this year, Lord, that you would just continue to open doors and provide both for the financial needs as well as just the other hurdles along the way, whether it's visas, whether it's just things related to the pandemic, whatever it is. And that, Lord, as this team moves over there, that you would just use them in a great way to be able to make disciples for Christ on the college campus. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Yeah. All right. Thank you, Deanna.
Thanks, Todd. See ya.
See ya.
As Deanna shared, she's in the process of raising the funds required to follow God's call to lead a team of campus missionaries in Zambia for the next couple of years. If you'd like to give specifically toward that ministry need, we've included a link in the YouTube description of this video and also on our church Facebook page. Whether you're able to give or not, we can all be praying that God would continue to provide for Deanna and the team that she'll be leading overseas, and that the Lord would use them in big ways in the lives of college students. While we aren't meeting face-to-face, we've been talking with one church member each week to learn more about one another and to be encouraged by our stories of faith. Today, we're zooming in on Pat Nolan. Take a look.
All right, Pat, I appreciate you joining me today. Why don't you start by telling us something that most people in our church may not know about you?
Well, Todd, pretty much I'm an open book. I've lived here all my life, so, you know, most people, they know me pretty well. And if there's, you know, anything that they want to know about me, I guess Facebook can fill in the blanks.
All right. Well, one thing I know about you is you did serve in the military for a little while. What branch were you in?
I did, yeah. In the Navy.
Okay. Okay.
Served in the Navy, USS Independence, CV-62.
Okay. Well, thanks for your service. Pat, do you have a favorite hymn or Christian song?
Yeah, I have quite a few. One of my favorites has to be by a guy by the name of Shy Lynn. My favorite song would be Theology Q&A. Which pretty much does like a question answer about who God is and our relationship to God, and I know a lot of people there, you know, some people, they're not real big on hip hop, but just like Christ has done me, you know, he's taken something dirty and cleaned it off, you know, for his glory. So,
yeah. Yeah. Charlene's got some good stuff.
Yeah.
Pat, do you have a favorite Bible verse or a Bible verse that has just kind of meant a lot to you in a particular time of your life?
One that sticks out the most, I have a lot of favorites, but one that sticks out the most would have to be 2 Samuel 12, verse 22 through 23. That helped me and Kelsey, my daughter, get through the loss of Avon, my grandson, her son, which she shared that verse with me after he passed away. And then later on, I learned that she learned it from you. So, you know, ever since then, it just, that verse just sticks in my head in times of, you know, a loss in your family. And it's got to be one of my top five favorites.
Yeah. Is that the verse where after David lost a son, he said, you know, I can't, you know, he can't Why come should back I? To me, but I'll go to him. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Reminds us we got that promise of eternal life and seeing our loved ones in heaven. Pat, would you share with us kind of a brief testimony of your when you were saved?
Well, I've always believed that there was a higher power. You know, I just didn't know who he was. I never really went to church when I was young. And the very few times that I went, you know, no one taught me anything. You know, I pretty much had to figure it out on my own, you know. So I pretty much stopped going. I would say probably 8 or 9. But it wasn't until, you know, when my mom passed away, you know, I kind of had this empty feeling inside. And, you know, that was when, you know, I met Danny Taylor, which I knew him from before. But, you know, he helped me along, you know, with my sinful condition and where I stood with God, and which it shook me. You know, I've never heard anything like that in my life. You know, I thought that I was always, you know, on good terms with God, and as long as I'd done good and did the right things, said the right things, that I'm okay. Well, you know, Danny Taylor helped me to understand that by taking me to the Word of God and showing me, you know, man's condition and God's promise to his people. So it was from that point on that emptiness that I had started, you know, it began to fill up, you know, with Christ. And it's been that ever since then.
Awesome. I guess Danny, he's all right.
Yeah.
We love to, when Pat and Danny and I are all together, we love to just take turns taking jabs at one another. So,
of course.
Pat, how can we pray for you or your family right now?
Just pray that we continue in our faith, continue in our walk with Christ, and pray that everything that we do in our life, that we do it for God's glory and God's glory alone.
Well, Pat, let me pray for you. Father, I just thank you for Pat being willing to hop on here today and to share a little bit about his story of faith and how you've just led him to trust Jesus over the years and walked with him. And Lord, I don't even know if he knows this, but he's been just a great encouragement to me as his pastor, reaching out with encouragement and just seeing his excitement for Jesus and to try to share others
with you at his workplace and wherever he goes. And Father, I pray that you would just be with him and his family right now, that they would just continue to grow closer to you, to glorify you. And we just ask that you would use him and his family for your kingdom. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, Pat. Thank you, sir.
Hey, thank you, Todd.
All right, appreciate it.
Psalm 113, verse 4 and 5 says, "The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, who is seated on high?" This next song reminds us that there is no one like our God. I hope you'll sing along. Turn in your Bible to Ruth chapter 1. We'll be in Ruth chapter 1 this morning. For the next 4 weeks or so, I'm going to be preaching through the book of Ruth. And this is a short book with just four chapters, but it contains a powerful story. It's difficult to pin down just one theme to this book, but it's a story that shows how God works in mysterious ways. It's for people who wonder where God is when one tragedy after another attacks their faith. It's a story for those who wonder whether a life of integrity in tough times is worth it. It's a story for those who can't imagine that anything great could ever come out of their ordinary faithfulness. It's a story for people that reminds us that God often puts just the right people in our path who show us kindness at just the right time that we need it. And it's a story that reminds us that God can bring redemption and healing from hopeless circumstances. And though it's a story born out of tragedy, it's a refreshing and encouraging book. And we're going to talk this morning in Ruth chapter 1 about faith in bitter times. And hopeful stories arise out of hopelessness. And this book begins by telling us that this was a dark time. In Ruth chapter 1 verse 1 it says, "In the days when the judges ruled." And the period of the judges was a 400-year period after Israel entered the promised land under Joshua and before there were any kings in Israel. And the book of Ruth falls right after the book of Judges in the Old Testament. And you can see from the very last verse in the book of Judges what kind of period it was. In Judges chapter 21, verse 25, it says, "In those days there was no king in Israel. Every man did what was right in his own eyes." It was a very dark time in Israel. The people would turn away from God and fall into sin. And God would punish their sin by sending enemies against them. The people would cry for help. And God would mercifully raise up a judge to deliver them. And this cycle continued for four centuries, with the people treating the Lord as sort of a genie in a bottle, only calling on Him to help when they got themselves into trouble, and then turning away from Him again almost as soon as God granted their pleas for help. And from all outward appearances, God's purposes for Israel were failing. And the book of Ruth helps us to see that God is at work even during the worst of times. Look at the last verse of the book of Ruth in Ruth chapter 4, verse 22. It says, "Obed fathered Jesse, and Jesse fathered David." The child born to Ruth and Boaz during the period of the judges is named Obed. And Obed became the father of Jesse, and Jesse became the father of David, who became one of Israel's greatest kings. And one of the main messages of this little book is that God is at work in the worst of times. Even though His people turn away, God never stops pursuing us in His love. And when you think that He is farthest from you or has turned against you, the truth is that God often is laying the foundation for a work of grace in your life. And so it was a dark time, but it became even a darker time. In verses 1 through 5, we read about how there was a famine in the land. And a man of Bethlehem in Judah went to sojourn in the country of Moab, he and his wife and his two sons. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife, Naomi. And the names of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Epaphrathites from Bethlehem in Judah, and they went into the country of Moab and remained there. And so these verses describe how there was a famine in Judah when Naomi and her husband and their two sons went to live in the country of Moab. And Naomi and Elimelech, her husband, rightly interpreted this famine as a sign of God's judgment. In Leviticus chapter 26, verse 3 and 4, the Bible said, God told His people, "If you walk in My statutes and observe My commandments and do them, then I will give you your rains in their season, and the land shall yield its increase." And so when the rains were withheld under the covenant God had made, it was a sign of His judgment against the people. So Elimelech and Naomi fled Judah for the country of Moab, probably in search of food or at least a fertile place to plant their crops. This was playing with fire because we know from the book of Judges and later in the book of Ruth that Moab was a pagan land with foreign gods. And God had called His people to be separate from the surrounding lands and their pagan worship. And so when Naomi's husband dies later on in verse 13, you can't blame her for feeling that maybe the judgment of God had followed her and added grief to the famine. And then in verse 4, it says that Naomi's sons took Moabite wives. One was named Orpah and the other Ruth. And again, the hand of God falls. And over a period of about 10 years, neither of her sons' marriages produces grandchildren. And then both sons die. In verse 5, it says both Mahlon and Chilion died, so that the woman was left without her two sons and her husband. And so Naomi's husband died, her sons have died, there are no grandchildren, there's this famine, they've moved to a pagan nation, she's lost her family, there's no heirs, and it's tragedy after tragedy, blow after blow strikes her family. And she and Elimelech had fled the darkness of Judah, but things had only gotten darker. Now what? Naomi decides that she's had enough. However bad things were in Judah, it can't be as bad as things had gotten in Moab. And so when Naomi gets word in verse 6 that the Lord had visited his people and given them food, she decided to return home to Judah. And verse 7 says, so she set out from the place where she was with her two daughters-in-law, and they went on the way to return to the land of Judah. And then beginning in verse 8 through 13, we see Naomi's attempts to turn back Ruth and Orpah. Naomi had these two widowed daughters-in-law named Ruth and Orpah, and they started to go back to Judah with her, probably out of love and concern for their mother-in-law. But then in verses 8 through 13, Naomi tries to persuade them to go back home. And John Piper posits at least maybe three reasons why the writer devotes this space to Naomi's effort to turn her daughter-in-law's back. And one is to illustrate Naomi's misery. In verse 11, Naomi said to her daughters-in-law, turn back, my daughters, why will you go with me? Have I yet sons in my womb that they may become your husbands? Turn back, my daughters, go your way, for I am too old to have a husband. In other words, Naomi had nothing to offer them. Her condition is worse than theirs. She's an older woman who is unable to have children, unable to have a family, unable to really work much in this agrarian economy, and she had no way of providing any sort of security for them. And if they wanted to be faithful to her and to the name of their husbands, they would find nothing but pain. And so she says at the end of verse 13, no, my daughters, it is exceedingly bitter to me for your sake that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me. In other words, Naomi feared that God was against her, and she didn't want her daughter-in-laws to continue to share in her misery. But another thing that we see is that this passage reminds us of an Israelite custom. The second reason for verses 8 through 13 is to set the stage for us by foreshadowing an Israelite custom that we're going to that's going to come into play later on in the following chapters. And the custom was that when an Israelite husband died, his brother or near relative was to marry the widow and to continue the brother's name. And this relative was known as a kinsman redeemer. And Naomi is referring to this custom in verse 11 when she says that she has no sons to marry Ruth and Orpah. She thinks it's hopeless for Ruth and Orpah to remain committed to her family when her family offers no future for them. And in the fog of the years that have passed and the pain that she's endured, Naomi apparently doesn't remember that there is another relative named Boaz who might perform the duty of a kinsman redeemer. And there's a lesson here. Often in the midst of difficult circumstances, we exaggerate the hopelessness of our situation. As pain and grief and stress and anxiety and depression close in around us, we can become so focused on the storm that we're in that we fail to see the rays of light peeping out around the clouds. Naomi felt that God had left her in a hopeless situation, but he hadn't. It was God who broke the famine in Judah so she could return home in verse 6. It was God that we're going to see in chapter 2 who preserves a kinsman to continue Naomi's line. And it was God who led Ruth to stick by Naomi's side. But Naomi is so embittered by God's providence that she can't see His mercy at work in her life. Sometimes we get that way too. Maybe you feel that way right now. Christian, don't forget that God has promised never to leave us or forsake us. Even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, He is with us. And the third reason that we see verses 8 through 13 is to help us to see the amazing faithfulness and kindness of Ruth. As we see Naomi's misery, as we see her plight, it sets the stage for us to understand what an amazing story of faithfulness that we see in Ruth's life toward Naomi. Verse 14 says that after hearing Naomi's plea, that Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye and went back home. But Naomi clung to her. And even after Naomi insisted Ruth return home, in verse 15, Ruth would not leave. Have you ever offered to do something for someone, but really in the back of your mind, you only offered because you never thought that they would actually accept your offer of help? Maybe you offered to help with your spouse with a chore, and thinking they'd say, "No thanks, I've got it." And instead, they took you up on your offer to help, and you found yourself for the next couple of hours engrossed in this job you didn't really want to do. And you thought, you know, if only I'd known they'd say yes, I wouldn't have offered to help. That's not what Ruth was doing. She truly cared for her mother-in-law and wanted to do all she could to be there for her. This is all the more amazing after Naomi's grim description of their future together. Ruth stays with her in spite of an apparently hopeless future of widowhood and childlessness. Naomi tried her best to talk Ruth out of her decision to stay. But Ruth's answer is found in chapter 1, verse 16 and 17. She said to Naomi, "Do not urge me to leave you or to return from following you. For where you go, I will go, and where you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord do so to me, and more also, if anything but death parts me from you." And so we see in Ruth's life and her response to Naomi's plight a picture of faith. The more that you ponder Ruth's answer to Naomi, the more astounding it becomes. First, it means leaving her own family and land in Moab. Second, it means, as far as she knows, a life of widowhood and childlessness, because as far as Ruth knows at this point, Naomi's family offers no prospects for her. Third, it means going to an unknown land with a new people and new customs and new language. Fourth, it was a lifetime commitment. As Ruth said, "Where you die, I will die, and there I'll be buried." In other words, she planned never to return home, even after Naomi died. But fifth, and I think the most amazing commitment of all, was this. In verse 16, she said, "Your God will be my God." Now, Naomi had just said, back in verse 13, "The hand of the Lord has gone out against me." Naomi's experience of God and testimony was bitterness. But in spite of this, Ruth forsook the religious heritage of her Moabite upbringing and made the God of Israel her God. And by the way, Naomi described Orpah's decision to return home in verse 15, Ruth may already have made that commitment to God years before. Perhaps she had heard her husband and his family describe the great love of God for Israel, the covenant that He had made with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the way that He had delivered for His people at saving them from slavery in Egypt and even at the Red Sea, and giving them a land to dwell in, and communicated His laws and purposes for them. Perhaps Ruth had been wrestling with her faith commitment for some time, and standing here at the crossroads with Naomi was her point of no turning back. Somehow or other, Ruth had come to trust in Naomi's God in spite of the bitter hand that Naomi had been dealt. And in Ruth, we have a picture of true faith. Faith in God that sees beyond the present trials and setbacks. Faith that chooses to follow God, even if it means missing out on the securities and comforts of this world. Faith that gives us courage to venture out into the unknown. Faith that inspires radical commitment to those that God has placed in our path. And I have to ask you today, have you placed your faith in Naomi's God, in Ruth's God, the God of the Bible? Not a genie in a bottle, God, get me out of this jam that I'm in kind of a faith, but have you said, I've decided to follow Jesus, no turning back. God, I'm going to trust you in good times and bad. I'm going to follow you even when I don't know what the future holds or what it's going to cost. I'm going to be faithful even when my marriage gets hard, when my friends make fun of me, when I lose my job, when tragedy strikes. In Luke chapter 14, Jesus warned that we must count the cost of being his disciple and that the Christian life won't be easy. But it's worth it no matter the cost. God longs for more men and women like Ruth who count the cost and trust him by faith and say, yes, I'm in it, Lord, for the long haul. So we see Ruth's example of faith, but we also see in Naomi's theology some right and some wrong. The last few verses of chapter 1 tell us a little bit more about Naomi's faith. Ruth and Naomi return together to Bethlehem in Judah in verse 19. And there's a reunion of sorts, and the people say, Naomi's home after all these years? But Naomi stands up and tells the people in verse 20, do not call me Naomi, which means pleasant or sweet. Call me Mara, which means bitter, for the Almighty has dealt very bitterly with me. I went away full, and the Lord has brought me back empty. Why call me Naomi when the Lord has testified against me, and the Almighty has brought calamity upon me? Naomi is sure about three things: that God exists, that God is sovereign, and that God has afflicted her. Most Christians struggle with that last one, but Naomi had a mature enough faith to say, like Job, shall we receive good from God and not receive evil? Naomi's problem wasn't that she believed that God had afflicted her. Her problem was that she had given up hope that God could redeem and bless her. She had forgotten the story of Joseph, who also went to a foreign country. He was sold as a slave. He was framed by an adulteress and who had him thrown into prison. He had every reason to say, like Naomi, the Almighty has dealt bitterly with me. But he kept his faith, and God turned it all around for good. And so Joseph was finally able to say in Genesis chapter 50, toward the end of his life, as for you, you meant it for evil against me, but God meant it for good. Naomi was right to believe in a sovereign, almighty God who governs the affairs of nations and families and even gives each day its part of pain and pleasure. But in her despair, she had forgotten to look for the signs of God's good purposes all around her. God had taken away the famine so she could return home. Notice the touch of hope at the end of verse 22. It says they came to Bethlehem at the beginning of barley harvest. If Naomi could only see what that would mean, not just the provision of food for her family at harvest time, but also a future for her family, as we're going to find out. Not only that, God had given her Ruth, this daughter-in-law who stuck beside her and became a daughter in love. What a blessing. All Naomi could say as she returned home in verse 21 was, I am empty and bitter. What would she have said if she could have seen that in Ruth she would gain a grandson, and that this grandson would be the grandfather of the greatest king of Israel, and that this king of Israel would foreshadow the King of Kings, Jesus Christ, the Lord of the universe, who would one day be born from her family tree? I think she might say, instead of I am empty and bitter, maybe she would have said, and we know that God works all things together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. Or maybe she would say what her great-great-grandson would go on to say in Psalm chapter 30, verse 5. For God's anger is but for a moment, but his favor is for a lifetime. Sorrow may last for the night, but joy comes in the morning. What about you? Maybe today you feel like Naomi, bitter, empty, defeated, hopeless. I want to plead with you to search for the rays of light. No matter how overwhelming the clouds of despair may seem, keep on looking for the glimpses of God's goodness and faithfulness peeking through. He's there. Don't assume that your present circumstances will last forever. No matter how difficult your today seems, know that God has offered a better tomorrow because of Jesus Christ. You see, just as Ruth was called by love to leave her home for a strange country and a difficult life, Jesus, the Son of God, willingly left the comfort and glory of heaven to live among us. He didn't have it easy, but he trusted his Father's will and lived a perfect sinless life and was faithful to death, even death on a cross. And on the cross, the Son of God drank the bitter cup of the Father's wrathful punishment against our sin, so that you and I might know that whatever trials we face in this life, they are designed not ultimately to punish our sin, but to prepare us for heaven. And because Jesus died and was raised, those who follow him by faith are promised that nothing we face on this earth can separate us from the love of God. And knowing that nothing can separate us from the love of God frees us to live like Ruth. If God calls, you can leave your job and your home, and you can follow God in radical ways. We heard a testimony earlier of how Deanna Deere is doing just that, even in the face of a global pandemic. He may not call you to the other side of the world, but he may call you to serve him in a way that you'd never expected. Or maybe it's not the faith to leave, but the faith to stay and be faithful where God has placed you. In a world where people give up on their marriages or break commitments the second a better offer is on the table, faith in God's purposes calls us to stick it out and see how God might bring beauty from ashes. When God's people say to him, God, where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. You'll be my God, and I will be your people. It gives us a joy that doesn't shrink back in hard times, and a perspective that doesn't lose its way in times of blessing. If you've never trusted Jesus and taken hold of these precious promises from God, I pray that today you would count the cost and choose to follow Jesus. From wherever you're watching, you can say, Lord, I don't claim to know and understand all your ways, but I believe that you're there for me because Jesus gave his life for me. And I don't deserve anything, God, but you've promised that you won't turn your back on your own son. And so I put my faith in Jesus, trusting that his death on the cross took the punishment for my sin, and that his resurrection from the dead gives me eternal life. And so, God, I want you to be my God, and I want to be one of your people. Thank you for saving me. And Lord, if there's someone today who's calling out to you for the first time like that, oh God, I want to rejoice with them and thank you for your promise that those who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. And Father, I pray you give them the courage this week to step out in faith and share that commitment of faith in Jesus with someone else, maybe by contacting our church, maybe by sharing it with a Christian friend. Father, if there's a believer in Jesus today who's heard this message, and maybe right now they're going through one of those bitter seasons of life in which it just seems that everywhere they turn, nothing is going right. Oh, Father, I pray as we look into your word this morning that we'd be reminded that sorrow may last for the night, but joy comes in the morning. And we thank you that we have a Savior who came so that no matter what we have to endure in this life, we can look forward to a better tomorrow. And I pray you'd help us to walk by faith. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Where you go?